said, "You're not fat enough to have type 2 diabetes."
It's skyrocketing. It's becoming an epidemic out there.
The central message is low-fat diet, and it probably works for some people, but it doesn't work for an awful lot of people.
Welcome everybody, and tonight a special guest, Michael Mosley, probably best known as the 5-2 guy. His 5-2 diet, based on intermittent fasting to lose weight and to improve health, became quite a thing worldwide. Now the doctor and the BBC science broadcaster is tackling type 2 diabetes with a plan to prevent and possibly reverse it. Michael Mosley, welcome.
Thank you.
When you look at this photo of yourself that was taken about 8 years ago, what do you?
It sits proudly in my mother's kitchen for reasons best known to. That is not a face or a body that anyone other than a mother could.
Well, I don't see it that badly, but you clearly do.
Do
you see?
I see quite a fat guy there. And this was about 8 years ago. But if you'd asked me, and indeed I pointed that photograph out to my wife, she said she never saw me as fat. I think it's probably the camera angle or something like that.
You don't look that big to me in that photo. How much extra weight were you carrying?
About 10 to 11 kilos more than I am now. And I was still pretty much within the sort of healthy range. But at that point, I was what was once described as a toffee. Thin on the outside, fat inside.
OK, you had a scan taken for a BBC documentary you were making on weight loss in 2009. Yep. What did that scan show?
Well, that showed something rather nasty, which was essentially that this is my scan. Can you see that lovely green stuff? That is all fat. Basically, that is... I can't even remember the amount of fat the expert said was in there, but it's casing my internal organs.
And none of it should have been there?
It should have been minimal. What I was carrying was an awful lot of visceral fat. And I guess he said to me at the time, look, if you go on like this, then you are at high risk of developing type 2 diabetes and having heart disease. And so he gave me a very sobering talking to.
Now, once you'd seen that scan, what did you do?
I went home and I talked to my wife about it, and I started on a low-fat diet because that seemed to be the right thing to do. And I also started exercising pretty vigorously for a while.
Mm-hmm. And how long did that last?
About 6 months. And then I just got really, really bored. And somehow or other, I allowed it to slip away, slip away, slip away.
This really interests me because you're a doctor.
Yeah.
You're a science broadcaster.
Yes, quite.
You make health documentaries for the BBC. And after 6 months, you gave up.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's just really tough. Losing weight is really, really hard, even when you are massively motivated. And you follow the best advice that's sort of available to you at the time. And my father had died of diabetes-related illnesses really very young, at the age of 74. And I saw his deterioration because he developed type 2 diabetes at pretty much exactly the age I was when I had the scan. So I had all the reasons in the world to do something about it, and I genuinely did try really, really hard.
So 4 years later...
Yep.
You went back to the doctor thinking you had a melanoma.
Yes.
What happened?
Well, she took a sample. She said, this doesn't look like a melanoma. It's not typical. That's fine. Let's take a blood test. And then she rang me up to say, I have bad news. You are a type 2 diabetic. And she said, let's start you on medication, because that's the kind of thing you do, particularly in the UK.
How did you react when you were told, given that your father had died?
I was really upset. You know, I was really upset. I went back and talked about it with Claire. And then I decided I would see if there was something else. So, fortunately, I was working at the time with a science team, some very clever people from the Horizon science series. So I said, you know, can you find out something else? And they went and kind of scoured the literature. And they said, let's have a go at intermittent fasting, which I'd never heard of.
Mm. And that's so how the whole 5-2 thing started.
Yeah. The evidence is pretty strong that if you go on some form of intermittent fasting, you can improve your insulin sensitivity and you will also lose body fat, particularly visceral fat. So that's kind of what I did.
Now, this was flying in the face of the messaging that was around at the time about what diet
should be.
I mean, what were you told you should be doing?
Well, essentially, it was a low-fat diet. I mean, we've known since the 80s and 70s and probably earlier than that that the central message is low-fat diet, and it probably works for some people, but it doesn't work for an awful lot of people. I had no or almost no interest in diet before that because at medical school we were really taught nothing about diet. My son is at medical school, he's taught almost nothing about diet. We learn about exotic diets, we learn about Kwashiorkor disease, we learn about deficiency diseases, but not what happens when somebody who is overweight comes and sits in front of you and says, what should I do?
OK, we're going to get on to diabetes because that's what we're here to talk about and the specific diabetes diet. But before we do, I want to meet a few people who've come along tonight because I know you're all interested in type 2 diabetes. Lou, you were diagnosed with type 2 when you were 27?
Yep.
5 years ago. What did your doctor say when he told you you had diabetes?
So it wasn't my doctor, it was my diabetes educator. When I first went in to see him, he said, you're not fat enough to have type 2 diabetes.
Okay.
So that was a bit awkward, obviously. You don't occupy two chairs, you're not fat enough to have type 2, it's not type 2.
Was this because you suspected you had it or had it been proven?
Yeah, I had been diagnosed with type 2, yep.
Were you overweight at all?
I was overweight, yeah.
Much?
Not by much, no.
Mm-hmm. What sort of things were you eating?
Very healthy foods, trying to anyway. Was eating a normal, what I can see, was a healthy diet. Yep.
Such as?
Salads, meat, fruit, veg. I was walking every day. I was just a very healthy diet. Mm.
Did you have any symptoms?
Was going to the bathroom a lot, drinking a lot. And when I was eating a lot of food. So I wasn't just eating a normal size, I was eating two portions and was still feeling hungry.
Okay, so things like sandwiches, for example, how many
were... I used to have two or three sandwiches at work.
For lunch?
Yep.
Okay. Was diabetes on your radar?
Nope,
not at all.
Nope.
Family history?
Nope, I'm adopted, so I had no family history that I knew at the time.
Hmm. And have you found out since?
So
anything?
I recently found my biological mother and she does have type 2 diabetes.
Okay. We know that being overweight puts you at risk of type 2 diabetes. How big a factor is family history?
It's strong. It's not the strongest. Age is probably the strongest. And you're very young and very unlucky, I have to say, to be a type 2 diabetic because normally when you're over 50, over 60, that's kind of when it tends to kick in.
Mm.
Gender as well, would be more likely if you were male. If you're non-Caucasian, then that's also a risk factor. If you're, you know, Asian or you're from, you know, other ethnic minority groups, you're much more at risk.
Muriel, you were also adopted, so that makes the family history thing difficult to find as well. Was diabetes on your radar when you were diagnosed 13 years ago?
Not at all. It was almost by accident. My doctor... I think I had, I was in Australia then, and my GP said, you know, I'll give you a blood test for anything, you know, and I was in my early 50s, and came back, and she said, you know, you're type 2 diabetes, and in those days, you know, we just thought, oh, all right, take medication, and that would solve it. We don't know as much as we do now, and my diet was like her, not that bad, although. As Asians, we eat a lot of rice and noodles, yeah? We didn't realise then that carbo was a big thing, you know? We thought, oh, just cut out the sweets. And that's what I did. And, it's been 13 years.
Do many people you know have diabetes?
Yes. Most of my ex-classmates who are back in Malaysia have diabetes.
And the generation previously, perhaps they wouldn't have. It seems to have sort of suddenly appeared
from
nowhere, doesn't it?
Yes.
Mm.
Yeah.
Maxine, do you know many people with type 2 diabetes?
I reckon just about majority of Aboriginal people got it. Aboriginal people know of that word. That word is so common out there, type 2 diabetes. But they don't know what it is.
Or what it means.
Or what it means.
Well, I think the broad community often doesn't know what it means and how dire the consequences can be of it.
When I was diagnosed, I wasn't like a shock horror. So all Aboriginal people get it.
Is that how you felt?
That's how I felt.
So were you resigned to it in a sense?
Yeah. You're going to get it sooner or later.
Michael?
Yes, no, it's very depressing, isn't it? It's depressing how common it is, and it's really depressing how common it's becoming in places like Malaysia, China, Vietnam. And as you say, in your community, it's up to 50%, isn't it?
Yeah, it's skyrocketing. It's becoming an epidemic out there. Like, I was diagnosed about 7 years ago with it, and I got rid of it. And I was just like, why aren't we educating people around it?
How did you get rid of it?
Well, there was two things that made me get rid of it. One, when the doctor said to me, your people find it hard. I went, what?
It was a challenge.
And I thought...
That's a terrible thing to say.
Your people find it hard, but I'll send you to a diabetic educator. I went, what's that? What do they do for a living, you know? And my diabetic educator made me feel culturally safe in her presence. I asked her one question. I said, so what does chronic mean? She said, mixing it's life-threatening. So you're saying it could kill me? Well, I better start doing something about it.
Okay, we'll talk a little bit later about what you actually did do about it, but this is a very important point because I think some people watching this might not be aware of just how life-threatening it is. Yes. Can you give an indication of how life-threatening it is?
Yes, I'm sure you all know, don't you, the statistics. At some level, doctors like to cushion it because actually the facts are extremely uncomfortable, which is if you are a type 2 diabetic, then it is one of the leading causes of blindness. It is probably the leading cause of impotence. It will double your risk of heart disease. It probably doubles your risk of dementia. It probably also cut 10 years off your life.
And do we know why particular ethnic groups are more inclined to get it?
No, not that I'm aware of. I don't know if you're aware of. We have one of the leading experts here. Mm. Is there any explanation?
Paul?
It's interesting that someone from with a Maltese background, Malaysian background, these groups appear actually to have a heightened susceptibility genetically. And yeah, certainly Asian Indian, our Australian Indigenous community appear to have a heightened susceptibility when they're facing the what we call the obesogenic environment.
Mahbub.
Yep.
Your parents, you're from Bangladesh, your
yes,
parents in Bangladesh,
yeah,
have it?
They live in Bangladesh, yes.
Okay, is it widespread in Bangladesh?
I think it is. It's becoming quite uncommon to find an auntie or uncle who's over 50 years of age and doesn't have it. I did a test 2 years back. That time, nothing was found. Everything was okay, except that I have a body mass not normal, but... otherwise, I think nothing was found. But
so are you doing anything at all to try and head... Like, given that you know family history can be a problem and it's widespread, are you doing anything to try and keep it at bay?
Having that family history, I'm scared to test.
Well, that's understandable.
I joined you there, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. So. But, I mean, I find this really interesting because, I mean, Michael's done it. We've all done it. You know, we've all known that maybe, you know, we're carrying a bit too much weight or there's something or other that we should be fixing and we don't do anything about it. And you're clearly in that category, Mahbub.
I am. And I mean, from my mum's side and dad's side, most of the, people who are around 50 have it. So I know that I have to test.
Ted, your Anglo background.
That's right.
When did you realise you had type 2 diabetes?
I went to see a doctor, one of my very rare visits to doctors, and it was when he asked me questions about when have you had a test for your blood sugar level, what's your cholesterol like, that I had to admit I hadn't been tested, even though I had a brother that died of diabetes. And it was then, after going to the doctor, that I found out that I had diabetes. And it was quite a surprise to me because even though I was calorie enhanced, I had...
Calorie enhanced! A whole new lexicon we're developing.
Calorie challenge.
Because I didn't eat much food that contained sugar, I thought, how can I be diabetic? But at the same time, I like starchy foods like breads and things. I love meats with all the fats, and I really wasn't doing the
So you weren't eating, you know, sweets.
No,
but you were eating other things, and you thought you therefore weren't eating sugar.
I lived alone, so you know, I tended to enjoy fast foods. A very bad mistake.
How are you though now with your weight? And with fast food and exercise?
Well controlled, but I do lapse occasionally because I like meats and red wine. I've got to be honest about that. So my weight can go up and down, but generally I know that it's entirely up to me to do what I can to be in good health.
Mm.
Yep.
Michael, you mentioned that your father was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes when you were training as a doctor. What advice did you give him at the time about what to eat and what not to eat?
Well, broadly, I told him he should go on a low-fat diet, which was the standard advice of the time, and that he should eat plenty of starchy foods.
And what do you think of that advice now?
I think it's probably not the right advice.
And what about low-fat products in general?
I wouldn't touch them. Generally, I think they're junk.
We don't want to put people in a position of being failures. Already, people are failures in diabetes too often.
Michael, tell us how you think we can get those numbers down.
Well, I think probably changing the diet. I mean, I think it's going to be really complex, really difficult, because there are enormous challenges. But I think perhaps changing what people eat and then teaching them more about the risks they face.
Now, you are proposing this idea of an 8-week, 800-calorie-a-day diet. How does it work?
This is based on the work of Professor Roy Taylor. The idea is that essentially it's kind of what it says on the tin. It's 800 calories a day pursued for 8 weeks, possibly longer. And the goal is to lose at least 10% of your body weight, possibly more during that period.
Is that the sole goal? Does it matter what you eat for those 800 calories?
I think for long-term maintenance afterwards as well, switching to a more Mediterranean-style diet will prove easier for more people. The honest truth is the best diet is the diet you can stick to. What we know again about Mediterranean diet is on the whole, when people are randomly allocated to it, they are much more likely to stick to it than they are to a low-fat diet. They just find it tastier.
Mm. Roy Taylor, Michael is the one popularising your science, if you like. I wonder if you can tell us a little bit about what you found that's led to this idea of this 8-week diet.
Sure. What I was trying to do was not find a cure for type 2 diabetes. I was trying to understand the nature of the condition. Now, there was a very important observation made back in 2006, which related to bariatric surgery. And so the exciting thing then was the observation that glucose levels went back to normal very soon after the operation, 7 days. Now, when I looked at that, I could see exactly what was going on. I could see that with a sudden reduction of calories, the body would use up the excess fat within the liver. That would allow the liver to function normally, and the same might happen in the pancreas and cause it to wake up and go back to normal. And that's where the 800-calorie diet came from. I needed to try and test that idea. We tested it, and to my surprise, it was very strikingly correct.
OK, so this is, we're talking about quite sudden weight loss here with a diet like this. I mean, bariatric surgery for people who have it, who are obese and who want to lose that weight, I mean, that's sudden weight loss that you're talking about. Are you saying it can reverse diabetes?
Absolutely back to normal. The important matter to grasp is the extent of what is required. We heard, for instance, from Lou earlier on, and she gave a beautifully clear description of getting type 2 diabetes, not very heavy, and at the age of 27. That's outrageous. But unfortunately, Lou has just got a constitution which is at risk. For Lou to get rid of her diabetes, then she needs to lose probably about 15% of her body weight of where she started.
Have you tried to do that, Lou?
No.
Would you try to do that?
My endocrinologist said that I could possibly reverse my type 2 diabetes. It would take a lot of work. I work in hospitality. I'm on my feet the whole time. I eat at weird hours. That's just my life at the moment. It's not viable for me.
So are you happier to be on medication than you would be to go off medication and do the hard work you have to do to get there?
Yep.
Okay, what do you think of that, Michael?
It's a strategy. I'm not sure it's a very good long-term strategy.
Roy, how strong is the science around this? I mean, I think that's what a lot of people want to know, because diet, you know, there are diets everywhere. They come and they go. You know, they're found to be wonderful one minute and completely debunked the next. How strong is the science that's supporting what you're saying around doing a diet over 8 weeks of 800 calories?
Well, Jenny, since we proved the original hypothesis was correct, that was 2011, we've worked consistently to try and put the science in place. And what we can say now is that type 2 diabetes is due to accumulation of fat in the liver and in the pancreas. And if that fat is shifted, then the body can go back to normal, at least in the early stages of type 2 diabetes, say the first 10 years.
OK, let's have a look at what 800 calories looks like. Lara, you have type 2 diabetes. You're in week 3 of this 8-week, 800 calorie a day diet. How are you finding it?
I'm very hungry.
All the time?
No, for about 2 hours after I eat, I'm okay, and then I start feeling hungry again.
How much were you eating before you started doing it? How much more were you eating a day?
At least 3 times more.
Three times more.
Probably, yeah.
So about 2,500 calories.
Yeah, probably.
Now, your weight so far has only come down 1 kilo, but your waist has come down and your blood sugar's down. Is that right?
Yes, actually, after three weeks? Today it's down 2 kilos, my weight, so that's good. My blood sugar's come down a huge amount.
By how much?
By 4 points. My blood sugar, actually, no, it's now... From 12, when I began, it's now 7.8 this morning was my fasting blood sugar in 3 weeks. That's fantastic.
Paul, Lara's result with the test she's doing just over the 3 weeks, is that an impressive result?
It's good. The point is, a fasting blood sugar of greater than 7 is a diagnostic test for diabetes. And there is a three-month accumulation of blood sugar. We call it the hemoglobin A1C test. I think the aim there would be to have your blood sugars 5 or 6 millimoles per litre, so to speak, and perhaps 2 hours after eating, a level under 8, for example.
Pen, you were diagnosed with type 2 diabetes 6 years ago. You've been on this diet for 3 weeks as well. How's it going for you?
Well, initially it was very hard. I've never been on a diet before. My wife has never been on a diet. I've gotten used to it, and it's amazing how the body can adjust.
Have you tested your results at all? What's it done to your body? Have you lost weight?
Yes, I've lost weight. The blood sugar seems to improve, but I expected that to improve anyway with the loss of weight. So it wasn't a real surprise or anything.
You don't sound very enthusiastic to me, Ken.
Well, I'd be very happy when I come off this diet. This was a terrible timing in a lot of ways because it was having to start this when the Lunar New Year celebrations were on. Having to, yeah.
Well, this is valid stuff. You know, people have things to do, honest, places to go.
I suspect if you weren't about to appear on a television programme, you might have shifted it to a more convenient time. I do not for a moment underestimate the problems or how challenging it is to lose weight by any means. It is tough. Yeah. I do think it's worth it. I honestly do believe...
Well, you believe it can actually reverse.
Well, I mean, ask Professor Taylor.
Professor Taylor. Because this is a contentious word, reverse, I know, in this world, to talk about that idea. I mean, is it appropriate to say that it can, in some people, reverse type 2 diabetes, Roy?
Yes, absolutely. Let me put some figures on that to explain where I'm coming from. In the first study, we studied 11 people who all reversed. They all had relatively short-term diabetes, less than 4 years from diagnosis. In the second study, which is just about to be published, we studied 29 people. They had a mixture of short and long duration diabetes. Now, of the people with diabetes of less than 10 years, we found that about 80% of them would reverse their diabetes completely.
And where does exercise fit in to all this? We've talked all about food. Where does exercise fit in?
That's a really important point, Jenny. During the weight loss phase, exercise is nowhere. Please do not increase your exercise whilst you're trying to lose weight. And the reason is the majority of people who've eaten their way into being too fat for their bodies really cannot undertake the sustained exercise that's necessary to shift weight. However, once the 8-week period is over and the weight has been lost, then exercise plays a really important part in the long term of keeping the weight off. So, two very different messages.
Okay, Paul.
I guess the first play is to be looking at what you've said, and that is the importance that the person will follow a diet, having a good diet. I've heard about 100 diets in my history, in time in diabetes, having the socioeconomic circumstances to be able to do it. So it's a dream that we can reverse everyone's diabetes, but we can do a hell of a lot of good for about 60% at least.
OK. Greg Johnson, what do you think of the 8-week, 800-calorie-a-day diet?
Well, I think we're talking about people with type 2 diabetes. So significant caloric restriction it does work, and there's no question. It's the GP guidelines we have in Australia identify that is a therapeutic alternative for people with type 2 diabetes. So there's no question. And then having a Mediterranean-style diet combined with physical activity and having your mind in the right place to sustain that works. So there's no fundamental problem with that, and severe caloric restriction does work. The real issue, I think, is two things. One is it's just not doable for a lot of people, and we don't want to put people in a position of being failures. Already people are failures in diabetes too often. They get told they've failed their treatment, they've failed this, they're not able to achieve something that the system imposes on them. And that's a real problem for their mental health and well-being and their ability to cope.
Roy?
Let's just talk about reverse for the moment. Reversing, yes. We're taking people off medication, including blood pressure medication. So the number of tablets they're taking is going down to zero in many cases. My longest duration patient, personally, is 11 and a half years. Now, 11 and a half years with normal blood glucose control, I would suggest to you, is reversed.
All right. This is all well and good.
Yeah.
If you know about food.
Yes.
Let's talk about food.
Okay,
We've got a whole lot here.
Yeah.
And I just wonder how, clear people are about what they actually should be eating or what's appropriate to eat. So I'll start with you, Muriel, actually. How much rice and bread would you eat if you could?
Well,
how important a part of your diet has it been?
At the moment, not very important.
But in the past?
But in the past, yes. Because, you know, with the Asian diet, you need to have rice. You can't eat curry without rice, you know? Mm. You can't eat spicy food without
rice. So are you finding it hard to try and cut back on those things?
Not now, but I used to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why does she have to cut back on those things? What does, you know, a bowl of rice or a whole lot of bread do to a person's body if they have diabetes?
Essentially, what's happening here with the foods which have quite a lot of sugar in it, but even bread has quite a lot of sugar in it. It also has easily digestible carbs. What happens is your body breaks it down very fast. You get a big spike in your blood sugar levels. Your pancreas pumps out the insulin. That will drive the blood sugar levels down again, but unfortunately, it often overcompensates. So you get a bit of a crash. And so a couple of hours later, you feel like, you know, having another snack.
But these turn into sugar.
These all turn into sugar.
Rice, pasta, bread, potatoes.
Yeah, pretty damn fast. So these things all pump up your blood sugars pretty fast because they are readily digestible. They have very little fiber in them. Bread, clearly it's better if it has more nuts in it, it has more less digestible stuff in it.
Now, all carbohydrates, these are all carbohydrates, they're not all equal, though. There are good carbohydrates and bad carbohydrates.
Pretty much everything on this table is a carbohydrate in its different life forms, if you like. You've got orange juice over here. You're thinking to yourself, orange juice, that has to be good. It comes from an orange, yeah? We're thinking orange juice is good? Unfortunately, orange juice is also, you know, that amount of orange juice there probably has the equivalent of about 3 or 4 teaspoons of sugar in it. It's a sugar delivery system.
Now, this is fresh orange juice.
Yeah.
What about a nice, big, milky coffee?
Sadly, I mean, I love nice, big, milky coffees, but they have a lot of sugar in the milk, which you should be aware of. The danger as well is if you go into the coffee shop to get the nice milky coffee, you will also get a muffin while you're there because it'll be sitting calling to you.
Okay, so let's break this down. I mean, we've got 400 mils of milky coffee in a big container like that.
It's about 5 teaspoons.
That's about 5.
So it's better than the orange juice.
One, two, three, four, five. That's without adding any sugar to it. That's just the milky coffee. Can we talk about yogurt?
Yogurt, basically, so we've got full fat and we've got...
We've got full fat here. So that's about 150 grams, I think, of yogurt each. That one's full fat with fresh berries.
Yep.
That one's low fat
with
berry flavour.
Which do you prefer? You're going for the one on the left. I'm going for the one on the left as well. The fat, you know, yeah, it's got more fat, but frankly, it's got more flavour in it. And this one has who knows what it's got in it. I really, really don't want to. It doesn't smell that great either.
And what about low-fat products in general?
I wouldn't touch them. Generally, I think they're junk. I think
Why?
They're just, manufacturers are just using them as a way to sell us stuff which is really unhealthy.
Why is it unhealthy? Why do you think low-fat products are... How can you generalise that much?
Broadly speaking, because, you know, when they take the fat out, it tastes terrible, so they just pump all sorts of other rubbish in. It's mainly sugar, but there are all sorts of other products. There are very few processed foods which are low-fat. As I said, the famous low-fat muffin. You could buy a low-fat muffin a few years ago where the number of calories was actually about 10% more than in the full-fat muffin. And people thought because it was low-fat, that meant it was low-calorie, which was obviously a complete and clear deception. But it was feeding on people's gullibility, and that's what food manufacturers do. They basically try and persuade people that what they're buying, which is actually a piece of processed junk, is somehow good for them.
I like the way you're so measured in your assessments of these things. What about things that are sweet but not bad for
you? These actually are very good. Berries on the whole, strawberries, raspberries, things like that.
And just finally, is this just unmitigated goodness?
This is pretty much unmitigated goodness over here, yeah. So cauliflower actually makes quite a decent rice. White rice, unfortunately, very high glycemic index, very high glycemic load. So if you can... and cauliflowers are relatively cheap. So I'm a big fan. All this stuff over here is kind of good.
I never kind of expected that it was, you know, when I was going into hospital that I was going to come out of it missing parts.
Greg, on the Diabetes Australia website, you headline the importance of a low-fat diet, recommending that people choose things like low-fat milk, yogurt, cheese, ice cream and custard. Why? Why do you recommend those low-fat products? I mean, it's clearly a difference of opinion here because Michael's saying you described low-fat foods as rubbish, didn't you?
Yes, sorry.
Yeah. So why are you advocating low-fat foods on the Diabetes Australia website?
I think
website?
That's just selective looking at our website at the moment. If you look at what we recommend, firstly, in the guidelines that we co-brand with the College of General Practice, we recommend a Mediterranean-style diet. It depends on what you're talking about. So, firstly, we have to think, are we giving advice to people who've got type 2 diabetes? Are we giving advice to people who may be low risk and or high risk with pre-diabetes? Our challenge is we've got a big audience here, right? You saw the numbers. In Australia right now, there's 1 million people who are diagnosed with type 2 diabetes as we speak. And growing every day.
But I guess what I'm wondering, why you're recommending low-fat products when saying at the same time, just be careful because a lot of them have, or some of them have, added sugar.
That's general. So the advice that's given it goes into our programs. And if you go and look at our programs and then we tailor the advice, and certainly our advice we give to people who are diagnosed with type 2 diabetes is start with weight reduction and start with good individualised advice from a health professional about how you're going to get weight reduction and how you're going to sustain that. And I think I totally agree with Michael's book that, if you head towards a Mediterranean-style diet with good physical activity and having your mind in the right place.
I had a really good look at your website and there are things... And I'm not saying one or other of you is right, but I'm interested in you having a conversation with one another because... You did headline low-fat, choose low-fat products. Yeah. It's right up the top of the website. It's one of the first things that you recommend. And you also emphasise the important role that carbohydrates play in our diet. But that's headlined as well. And you say that pasta is low GI and Michael's got it in the bad category over here. So I'm just trying to work out how the average person makes sense of all of this. I mean, Michael, you've seen the Diabetes Australia website. What do you think?
I have, and I do sympathise. You're facing a very broad thing, and I think you're also facing a major cultural shift, which is the move from low-fat to something different.
There's no question that the low-fat movement over the past, 20 years, has become an industry. A lot of foods are presented and marketed as low-fat, but they're high in added sugar, high in added
salt. So why don't you say that on the website?
Because that's complicated, and we do that. I mean, we're very active in that. I tell you, I sat for 2 years on the government, lobbying the government to introduce front-of-pack labelling so people would know how much added fat, added sugar and added salt was in the foods that they buy, just like you've gone through now. So we work very hard at that. Mm.
And Michael, my challenge to you is around this idea of the 800 calories a day for 8 weeks diet. Yeah. I mean, how can we know, given that we know people's metabolisms are different and everything else, that, people aren't going to cling to this and think it's going to be my saviour when it might not be? Probably doesn't work for everybody.
Over to Roy.
Well, that's a very good point. I think it's very important that we identify what we know and what we don't know. What we know is that motivated volunteers, given the 800-calorie diet as a pre-packed liquid formula diet, will reliably lose weight. The evidence is accumulating. The scientific basis, picking up Jenny's point, is very clear. The way in which we use it and what doctors say to patients, that is still being developed. And so you understand that there is a lag phase just now in applying simple science to really what we advise people in clinical practice.
Maxine, did you know all of this about food when you were diagnosed with diabetes 8 years ago?
I look at what I'm hearing today is very confusing because, the reason being is I've been on that journey of having type 2 diabetes. I've made a huge big transformation of weight loss.
How much did you lose?
I lost about 35 kilos.
Wow.
Over what period of time, Maxine?
And this is proof to me that I lost it. I used to wear this and I couldn't even do the buttons up on it.
Blimey.
And wow. I just...
So how did you do it?
And then
How did you lose the weight?
In a nutshell, I changed all that bready stuff. I will not eat a loaf of bread or a slice of bread now. I'm fearful of it. I don't eat any dairy products. That's what I used to have, full cream milk with cereal. And
so what do you eat now?
I eat 5 veggies, 6 veggies.
How helpful was your doctor?
He didn't help me at all. He just said it. He just referred me to a diabetic educator, something I didn't even know existed.
Mm-hmm. How do you think you get those messages across to other Aboriginal people in Australia?
Well, I'm getting across now. They come up to me and they go, "Hey, sister, how did you get like that? What diet are you on?" I go, "I'm not on a diet. I'm on a life change journey. I've changed all my bad habits of bowls of ice cream, thick shakes, McDonald's, all that quick fix food, quick fix. I want a quick fix. I go and get McDonald's. I've changed all that."
Could I just make a comment?
Yeah.
And it'd be a pity if anyone left here thinking any specific diet was greater than another.
Yeah.
We've known for 40 years if people lose weight, they can actually lose their diabetes, but if they put the weight back on, it comes. And I think Michael will agree with that. And I think that's the important thing. There are a lot of diets around. There's hundreds of them around. Mm. You need the behavioural issue to want to follow a diet, even Weight Watchers or any others. Mm.
Michael, you've had diabetes for about 14 years. What toll has it taken on your body?
Quite a big one, really. I suppose when I first found out about it, I didn't really take very good care of my diabetes. And in 2007, I ended up getting like a blister on the bottom of my right foot. And so one day I basically kind of, my foot was swollen. It started kind of progressing up my leg. So I went to see the doctor. He said, "Well, you take these antibiotics. If it's no better tomorrow, come back." So it wasn't any better tomorrow. I went back. He said, basically, "We'll pack a bag, go to casualty." And so I went up there, drove myself there, thinking that, you know, I'll just be on IV antibiotics for a couple of days. And that was on a Wednesday. Come Sunday morning, I ended up having my 3 smaller toes amputated, as well as then a lot of the skin behind that area. And that then led to, I mean, it was quite traumatic. I mean, I never kind of expected that it was, you know, when I was going into hospital, that I was going to come out of it missing parts, really.
So you knew you had diabetes at this point?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Your vision is affected as well?
Yep.
How is it affected?
Well, I know that it's getting worse. It's deteriorating. So, you know, I see my optometrist regularly. I mean, I was only there last week getting checked and things like that. And my peripheral vision is okay, but I found over the years that I need to get stronger contact lenses, going from like to multifocal lenses and things like that as well. So,
how much medication are you taking?
Quite a lot.
How much a day?
I take 2 tablets of Diform, Dibex, Metformin of a nighttime, but probably 7 injections of insulin a day.
And have you tried to lose weight, more weight?
Oh, not seriously, no.
Why?
Just a lack of motivation, I suppose, even though I know what the effects can be. I mean, my father was diabetic as well too. And he had a heart attack, died of a stroke a few years ago when he was only 71. But I think you've got to find that kind of motivation within yourself, that desire to want to lose weight, to improve.
And why do you think you haven't found it?
I think that it's kind of life situation as well. I mean, I think that diabetes probably brings a bit of depression as well too to people, and so I find that it's difficult to kind of, because of that, get myself motivated to go out and walk. And I suppose it's also that problem. I mean, not because of having less toes, and also the arrangement of my foot structure as well too means that for me going for a walk could result in getting an ulcer. And I've been into the hospital too many times I can even count. Mm. I mean, I became on first name basis with the nurses because I was in and out of the same ward at the RPA so many times.
So this is the kind of spiral, isn't it? That when you find yourself in these situations, you suddenly find as you get more sick, you're more limited in what you can do.
That's right.
And what do you think about what you've heard tonight? I mean, is it changing your thoughts about food at all?
Oh, I think that a lot of the stuff that we've said is kind of common sense. I think that most people realise that this is the bad stuff and that's the really good stuff. But I think as well too, though, that knowing that there's a plan, like the 800 calorie diet plan that I can follow, that would be certainly better for me because I tend to be fairly organised and I like making lists and I like making a plan. And so if I know what's coming up, then I think that it's going to be easier to
follow.
OK,
you're on. Yeah. So we will get in contact, yes?
OK.
And would you give it a go?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah.
You will give it a go?
Yep.
Interesting.
I can also introduce you to a community of people who have been in exactly your place, if you like, who will help you with it.
Which leads me to ask you about somebody like Michael. Yeah. I mean, we're talking about, you know, we've talked about people who are prone to diabetes, who might have a spike in blood sugar, who have diabetes. But what about somebody who's got advanced diabetes like this? Can losing weight have a significant impact on someone like Michael?
I do believe it will. I do believe that actually the exercise component is relatively unimportant compared to the weight loss. I absolutely understand why walking is a huge problem for you at the moment. It is possible that, you know, your diabetes is sufficiently advanced that you may not achieve full remission or something like that. But I have no doubt whatsoever that if you lost significant amounts of weight, you would feel better.
Yeah.
And you would feel better about yourself as well, which I think is a hugely important part of it.
Mm. Yes.
So what happens after the 8 weeks? Do we need to do something about it or...?
Unfortunately, you cannot return to your old ways, because if you return to your old ways, you will simply put the weight back on. As Professor Taylor was saying, at that point, you will probably need to significantly raise the amount of exercise you do. Because exercise is a terrible way of losing weight, but it's a fantastic way of keeping weight off. I still think that switching to a Mediterranean style... my wife is a GP. She sees a lot of Asian patients where she works. And obviously, Mediterranean is not quite the same if you're Indian.
Yes.
She said the biggest challenge is persuading them not to eat chapatis. Apparently, there is no good alternative.
Chapatis is not so bad, but, you know, for us, no meal is complete without rice. You have to have a bed of rice, and then you put whatever...
Try cauliflower. Honestly, try cauliflower. You're not convinced, I can
tell.
He
does not look convinced one little bit.
Even with cauliflower, you know, the portions that you showed me, those are the side dishes, and indeed, then you have to have a bit of rice. Otherwise, no meal is complete.
I'm afraid this is going to be a significant shift. Your plate is going to need to have lots of vegetables on it. It can have modest amounts of rice. It can have meat, but it is going to require those things.
Paul, just quickly, are there some people, if there's a family history, who are just going to get diabetes no matter what they do?
Yes, I think Roy will agree with me. There are lean people who are not obese, who've got a very high genetic susceptibility within the family, and they'll get diabetes, and the diet may help reduce their cholesterol and other risk factors for heart disease. There is a definite group who will benefit with what we've heard tonight. Mm-hmm. There are others who, for other reasons, high genetic susceptibility, being on medications which can aggravate diabetes rather than cause it, for example. But that's the score. Roy?
Michael, Roy, just very quickly.
Yes. Of course, Paul and I agree on just about everything and have done for a long time. But I would say the group of people who have such a genetic burden that the amount of fat in the body doesn't matter is really very small, about 1%. Everybody else with type 2 diabetes has become too fat for their bodies. And we see this in populations.
Michael, we do have to wrap up. What if it turns out that the idea of an 8-week, 800-calorie-a-day diet is in 5 or 6 years' time as out of date as low-fat diets are, or the other medical advice that you were given when you were a medical student? What then?
It's always possible. I think it's unlikely. I think that calorie restriction in one form or another is likely to form a basis of any sort of weight loss program. I think it's wildly unlikely. In 5 years' time, we're going to discover that eating chocolate is the cure for obesity or anything like that. Sad, but probably sure. So I think what's going to be interesting is that Roy's studies will come out within a couple of years. We'll learn more. We are learning more all the time. The main thing I guess I'm trying to do is say, look, there is a massive threat here. There is a great big threat which most people are not aware of. And it's not just people with type 2 diabetes, it's all those other people with pre-diabetes who are heading towards a fate which they can do something about now. I mean, I do applaud the efforts of the Australian Diabetes Association and everybody else who is screaming and shouting, this is a real threat, we must act.
Good note to end on. Thank you all very much for joining us tonight, and that is all we have time for here, but I'm sure you're going to want to keep talking about this on Twitter and on Facebook. Get away from the chopper. How did you react initially when you retired?
Within 5 minutes, I was bawling. I was crying. It felt like I was put out to pasture.
I'm not qualified at anything to earn money.
I just put all of my eggs in one basket.
For some reason, I can't let go because that elusive gold medal never happened.
Your promising AFL career was cut short last year.
I wish I was able to go out there and run around and play sport with the boys.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.